Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Richard Wilson, the Bard Music Festival's honorary stone guest. I arrived 30 years ago and ossification set in right away. Now, I know that some of you, perhaps all of you, have come to this talk hoping to hear about the octatonic scale. The demand has been quite extraordinary, perhaps short of a populist uprising, but it's been something. And in order to do this and to give it some context, I have to say a few things that you already know. Now, the most popular scale is the major scale. Let us count the number of notes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. But the next note is not a new note. Is the same as the first note, up an octave. Musicians talk that way. They say, this is all the same note, even though it sounds different, but it's in a different register. But what we have here is seven different notes. And they're not all equally spaced. We have what we call major seconds, or whole steps. And then there's a half step. And that pattern is repeated. So there are two half steps. And those half steps have a little bit of push toward the next note. You want to go on and then... Now, if you make a whole scale out of those half steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and then the first note up an octave. But there are only 12 different notes there. That push that I spoke of gets kind of lost. You can get disoriented in the chromatic scale and not know really until I tell you where that first note is. You can also make a scale out of the whole steps. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then the first note again. And similarly, a sense of disorientation, not knowing quite where we are in the scale, comes from all of the intervals being the same. Now, if you make a scale that alternates the whole steps and the half steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and then the first note repeated. 8 notes, thus octatonic. Of course, you have to decide whether you're going to start with the whole step and make the pattern, or start with the half step and then the whole step, which either you get two possibilities, and they are quite similar. Now, who invented the octatonic scale? I don't know. Examples have been traced or found slight, have been spotted in Scarlatti or Bach. My favorite example of an early octatonic scale is this from this piece. Which is a Beethoven sonata, early Beethoven sonata. And on page 2 of that, we find a few wrong notes, sorry. But what happens there, now if I kind of do a skeleton of it, So the bass line that's our octatonic scale. Now, in Rimsky, Sadko, Act One, here's an example of also a bass in the octatonic scale. Two octaves of that. Now this scale and the harmonies that are generated from it become more influential and widespread in that influence than you might imagine. Could I have example one, Jake?
In this new version, you will hear a new story, new characters, new jokes, and with luck, an ending.
That was the voice of Jack Benny, a radio program April 18th, 1948, introducing a skit called Murder at the Racket Club. But those chords you heard were formed on the octatonic scale. You didn't think I could work Jack Benny into a Rimsky-Korsakov. Now, the whole tone scale. There are some early and rather influential occurrences of the whole tone scale, and they're found particularly in Glinka and Dargaminsky. I'm not able to pronounce things here, Dargaminsky. Ruslan and Ludmilla, overture, near the end. The bass line goes straight down the whole tone scale. And Dargomishki's The Stone Guest. Here's an example from Act Three. This bass. Straight, often cited as the first kind of identifiable whole tones scale example. Now, of course, Debussy gets a hold of it, and to good effect. In the piano prelude voix. Now, harmonizing that octatonic scale, let me go back to that. I'm sorry, I keep turning around here. I don't know what I'm doing. The octatonic scale, let's go back to that because I want to show you some harmonizations of it. Both the whole tone and octatonic scale have the property of stabilizing an interval called the diabolus in musica, the tritone. Called the devilish because to medieval singers particularly, it was very difficult to sing. And it falls between two consonant intervals. And what the octatonic scale does is put it on both versions, falls on that scale, and with the whole tone scale, it's all around it. And what I'd like to point out is that you can form within these scales chords on the notes of the tritone. And it gives this very unusual color difference, which you can even make dominant sevenths on them. And they have this intriguing sound, which Mussorgsky uses to good effect in the coronation scene from Boris to convey the Kremlin bells. These are dominant sevenths that are on notes a tritone apart. And last night, if you were at Scheherazade, you heard these remarkable conversations between the bold and striking and in-your-face trombone section going, and then the very distant muted trumpet. And those are on chords that are separated similarly by the tritone. Well, there are other scales possible. The pentatonic scale, the five-note scale, corresponds to the black notes of the piano. And if I go all the way up to the first note, I find there are little gaps in the scale. Minor third gap. And there is the Hungarian scale, which has two gaps, and that immediately suggests, it's sometimes called the gypsy scale. Hard not to think of Carmen. And then what about Lazar Zaminsky's Hebrew Rhapsody? Where it gives a Hebrew inflection. Let's hear that example too. Now, Rimsky was famously a teacher of orchestration, and Zaminsky was his pupil. And orchestration does not necessarily involve an orchestra. And I my ear caught this little bit of a phrase, which I thought I'd play for you, because you can hear how the violin is sandwiched between highly placed piano lines. One of them anchors below, and one tinkles above. And it's just a very beautiful sound image. Example three. There's another instance of that Hungarian scale, which we heard if we were at Demon a few weeks ago in the Act II wedding preparation scene. Igor Stravinsky became intrigued with a scale that has gaps alternating with whole steps. And he pits that against a chromatic scale. And if I fit his harmonies in there, framework that fitted with the harmonies makes one of the most beautiful lead-ins to a presentation of a melody. The melody in question not being by Stravinsky, but being from Rimsky's folk song collection. We heard about that on Friday night. In Rimsky's harmonization, it sounds very hymnal. And the chords change with the notes of the melody, whereas in Stravinsky, the harmony is placed above the melody. It just says shimmering, the violins shimmering away, and the melody goes its own way with the French horn and the orchestration. Slow changes harmony above. Again, a very beautiful orchestrational effect. Now, despite a prevailing interest in chromaticism, many works on our program stay firmly within the major scale. Because many valuable harmonic progressions can be made with no alteration of the scale, we can go. Or. Or. Not a single chromatic note, nothing outside of the scale. The opening of Respighi's Bersuis. Remember, Richard Truskin mentioned that Respighi had a slight connection to Rimsky. I mean, he had some lessons, perhaps four or five lessons, but found them extremely valuable. But that's why he's on our program. But his Bersuis stays strictly within the scale for quite a few measures. Example four, please. Couple of chords outside. Example five, please. A couple of chords here. Two chords and then back to C major. Now, Alexander Cherepnin gained a measure of fame by inventing a nine-note scale. In the pieces on our program today, he remains very loyal to the major scale at the end of Bagatelle 8. Example 6, please. Or the chromatic scale at the beginning of Bagatelle 10. Now, you might be tiring of scales. Let's consider Gnesin and his Requiem for piano and string quartet. The piece starts with a piano solo that goes like this. Pause with unresolved chord, then it starts a little bit lower in pitch. Then another pause, another unresolved chord, and then a more intense, which ends, and which is that progression I was talking about, the tritone separation. This bears a suspicious, in its design, resemblance to a pause, and more intensive thing. I don't know why that drum sound is. The influence of Wagner is ever present. And it was perhaps because I was playing it too fast, I didn't say this, but I meant to before. About that tritone and those chords that were separated, why didn't I say what I wanted to say here? I think it's too late to do that. Gnesin's Requiem, later on, after the piano starts alone, the strings come in, and then the piano sits out, and the strings have a fugue. And this has become a rather predictable feature of these things. It's a Russian composers wanting to show their mastery of counterpoint. Here's a bit of the fugue. It's almost a textbook example of a fugue. If you can stop it now, okay. The voices come in exactly on time and you can very clear what's happening. Now, I may be yielding to a frivolity, but listen for a moment to the beginning of the third movement of Miaskovsky's second sonata. Okay, that's good. Okay, and a bit of number 10. That's too small a bit. All right. Sometimes these influences are a very obvious kind. Now, a most unusual item on this program is the work that Debussy wrote at age 18 during a period when he was visiting Madame von Meck of Tchaikovsky fame. He was giving some piano lessons and helping to take care of her many children, and he and the Madame would play piano duets, four hands, and that's probably why this one movement, Symphony in B minor, exists in that form. And toward the end of the movement comes a passage suggesting trumpet fanfares. Number. Now, 20 years later, Debussy produces one of the most memorable of all passages of orchestration. And it's my thought that this procession of muted trumpets that we hear in what I'm about to play you is foreshadowed in that early four-hand piano work. Second nocturne fête. It's hard to stop it. This is a program you're going to enjoy. Thank you very much for coming.